Unit 2, Social Group, Social Anthropology and Culture. Contents 2.1, Introduction, 2.2, Primary Group. Subpart is Characteristics of Primary Group, Importance of a Primary Group. 2.3, Secondary Group, Characteristics of Secondary Group. 2.4, Community. 2.5, Association. 2.6, Organizations, Formal and Informal. 2.7, Summary, References, Suggested Reading and Sample Questions. Learning Objectives. After studying the unit, you will be able to understand what a group is, its formation and types. Know about primary and secondary groups and their characteristics. Define a community. Identify an association and differentiate between formal and informal organizations. Introduction. Humans are social beings. They live together and form a society. Although they make society, neither they can see it nor can they touch it. But what all they can do is that they can perceive the society. They can feel the presence of society all around them. It is the basic reason behind calling society as an abstract entity. But if society is abstract, how can we study that abstract article? Now let us think of these aspects from different point of view. When a human being takes birth, he or she has certain needs to fulfill for which he or she depends on others individuals. In this process, he or she interacts with other individuals of society and establishes social relationship. These social interactions take place between two or more individuals. The whole collection of individuals in which social interaction take place is called as social group. It is the group in a form or the other which fulfills various needs of an individual. It provides a medium for social interaction. A person can easily identify those groups with which he makes relations in order to fulfill his needs. It means we can see the individuals that form a group. In other words, through these groups, we can experience the society which is considered as abstract in itself. So we can say that even though group is small, still it is the true representative of society, reflection of society. Till now, three things are very clear regarding the group. One, group is basic element of society and is a concrete phenomenon. Second, the group requires more than one individual. And third, there is a compulsory interaction between the individuals forming a group, that is social relationship. The elaboration of idea of social relations within a group of individuals can be seen in the writings of German sociologist Max Weber. His opinion that it is the mutual awareness or mutual recognition that establishes the relations among the group members, and it is the system of social relations that serves as a mean to fulfill the common interest of all the members. Talcott Parsons, 1951, considers culture as a basic element behind social relationships. It is the culture which defines the patterns of behavior in a group, which are shared by all the members of the group. These shared norms or patterns define the roles of members and differentiate them from non-members. Anderson and Parker, 1966, gave a comprehensive definition of group. Groups are units of two or more people meeting in a same environment or overcoming distance by some means of communication, who are influencing each other psychologically. The distinctive bond of the group is reciprocal interaction. Friends in conversation, a committee in action, and children playing together are example. This definition of group implies that the relations among group members are not temporary. They are recurrent and influence the other members of the group. That is, members are conscious about the presence of the other members. This consciousness of membership influences their behavior and also differentiates a group. Hence, group is not only a physical collection of people or an aggregation, while it is a collection of people who share common characteristics and organized pattern of persistent interaction and are aware of each other's presence. Recurrent nature of interaction among the group members makes the group one of the most stable social units of the society. They endure for a long period and make the society sustained. They are important for both to their members and for the society at large. As we have already discussed, groups fulfill the needs of its members. They also perform the member of functions like socialization necessary for maintenance of society. To sum up, we can say that social groups is a social unit which has the following basic elements: A. An aggregation of two or more individuals. B. Definite relations among the members comprising it. C. Mutual awareness or consciousness. Since group is a collection of interacting individuals, the level of interaction can be of many types and group membership can be acquired in a number of ways. So, social groups can be classified in a variety of ways. Different scholars have seen groups from different point of views and classified groups in different ways. There is broad range of facts on whose basis groups have been classified. Some of the chief bases include functions, size, stability, status, rule of membership, degree of interaction, and many more. A very important classification of groups was made by C.H. Cooley, 1909. On the basis of his works, two types of groups were identified, that is, primary and secondary groups. Although Cooley has never mentioned the term secondary groups in his writings, but other scholars have popularized the term secondary group to those groups which do not fall in the category of primary groups. Now we would deal with these two types of groups in detail and would see their importance in social life. Primary group 2.2. Primary group. Primary group are those groups in which a smaller number of persons come into direct contact with one another. There is a sense of mutual cooperation, companionship, and sharing of personal feelings. They are small groups and every person necessarily belongs to any of the primary groups. Due to their important nature, they form the nucleus of the social organizations. We have already mentioned that primary groups for the very first time were recognized by C.H. Cooley 1909 in his very famous book Social Organization, Human Nature and Social Order. He has observed intimate and close social relations among the members of certain small groups and termed those groups as primary groups. In his analysis of primary group, he defined it in terms of face-to-face interaction, cooperation and association, emotional involvement, identification, and sentiments of loyalty. In primary groups, emotions and sentiments carry more importance than the size of the group. Primary group is considered to be a product of long and intimate informal interaction. The relations among the members of primary groups are as in themselves not a mean to those ends. For Cooley, primary groups mean those characterized by intimate face-to-face association and cooperation. They are primary in several senses, but chiefly in that they are fundamental in forming the social order and ideas of individual. He further adds, the result of intimate association psychologically is a certain fusion of individuality in a common whole, so that one's very self, for many purposes at least, is the common life and purpose of the group. Perhaps the simplest way of describing this wholeness is by saying that it is a V, W-E-V. It involves the social of sympathy. It involves the sort of sympathy and mutual identification for which V is the natural expression. One lives in the feeling of the whole and finds the chief aim of his will in that feeling. Cooley considers family, playmates of children, neighborhood and community groups, and groups of elders as primary groups. He believes in the universal presence of these primary groups in all the times and all the stages of development. He argues upon the presence of some degree of primary relation in all sorts of the groups. This primary association creates consensus which further adds a V feeling among the group members. Thus, primary association is seen in all the groups and cannot therefore be used as the basis of differentiation between primary and secondary groups. The large number of people cannot interact in a highly personal and face-to-face manner, and they tend to break down into small, more intense cliques. So a primary group consists of a small number of people who interact in intense, direct and personal manner. The relationship between the members carry an emotional depth, and the group is likely to endure for a longer time. The members know each other at personal level and share their experiences, gossip agreeably, and feel the need for intimate human companionship. Three essential conditions have been identified for a primary group formation: close face-to-face proximity, smallness of the group, durability of the bond. For intimacy to develop, physical proximity is necessity that is provided best by face-to-face association. Talking and seeking each other makes easy the exchange of ideas, feelings, opinions, and sentiments. Physical proximity provides opportunity and conducive conditions for the development of primary groups. Group size is also important. Sensory contact is not possible with many people at the same time. Small groups tend individuals to come closer and facilitates personal interactions. The smaller the group, the more intimate it will be. As the group becomes larger, it dilutes the intensity of relations among members, and individuals also lose their individuality. Intimacy is determined largely by the frequency and intensity of association. The longer people are together, the deeper the contacts between them. Gradual and regular interchanges of habits and ideas deepen the social ties. Physical proximity, smaller size, and long duration are the conditions that facilitate the development of close relationships. All the three conditions are not mandatory for the origin of the primary groups. Rather, they define the most favorable conditions for the development of high level of the primary relations. 2.2.1 Characteristics of primary group. Characteristics of the primary group can be divided into two broad categories, that is, external characters and internal characters. External characters include following aspects: physical proximity among group members, small size of the group, stability and durability, continuity in the relations. Internal characteristics includes common objective of the group, the relations are ends in themselves, relationships are spontaneous, personal relationships, inclusive relations among members, control over the members. Common objectives of the group, the relation are ends in themselves, relationship are spontaneous, personal relations, inclusive relations among members, control over the members. Primary groups are essential for social life. They play a very important role in an individual's life, very crucial role. They are significant at both level and social level. They provide the medium through which we learn our culture and patterns of behavior. Some of the main points regarding the importance of a primary group are given below. 2.2.2 Importance of primary group. At the level of individual, a primary group helps in development of personality, increases the efficiency of individual, fulfills the psychological needs. At the level of society, a primary group transfer the culture from one generation to another, transfers the one culture from one generation to another generation, carries cultural norms of society within the society, carries cultural norms of the society within the society, provides means of social control and helps maintaining the social order, provides means of social control and helps maintaining the social order, ensure the performance of social roles in accordance with society norms, ensure the performance of social roles in accordance with society norms. Though primary relations and primary groups seem to be very important for the society, it would be over imperative to consider them as ideal for social interaction. At times, primary groups interfere with other elements of the society. At the time of making objective decisions, primary relations create hurdle. For example, if a teacher shows leniency towards a student and give him high marks which he doesn't deserve, it would be considered as dysfunctional. For example, if a teacher shows leniency towards a student and gives him high marks which he does not deserve, it would be considered as dysfunctional. Many situations arise in modern society where primary relationships are inappropriate at best and harmful at worst. In large bureaucratic structures so necessary to contemporary organizations, impersonality is more appropriate than intimacy. Routine is more important than spontaneity, and division of labor more necessary than versatility. Societies and sub-societies composed of tight network of primary relationships are often more tolerant of differences, more resistant to change, and less receptive to freedom than societies where relationships are more casual. Merrill, 1969. Moreover, primary groups assert its control over its members in the form of restrictions, conformity, and reactions. For example, a family provides liberties to its members and at the same time imposes restrictions on them. A peer group fosters the conformity in the group. Primary group also resist the intellectual, industrial, and educational changes in order to maintain its hereditary ties. Reflection. Typical examples of primary groups. First is an army group. The army group, soldiers form primary groups with their commandants and form informal relationships within formal settings in order to defend its members against the arbitrary authority of officers. Second, the peer group. Boys and girls of the same age group and approximately same social background as in a class form a primary group and have personal social interaction, chatting, that means, which also helps in their personality development. Third is the clique. It is a form of friendship developed between two or more persons which bring them into joint activity. It satisfies the emotional needs of a person to be loved and respected by his peers. Example, cliques of Indian students in Australia University. In this discussion, we learned that primary groups are the basic groups of the society. A human being starts life from primary group, develops personality in primary group, and throughout life one remains a part of one or another primary group. But there are other groups which are important equally, if not more, in an individual's life. They are distinguished from primary groups and are called as secondary groups. Now let us read some more about secondary groups and the reason behind their formation. 2.3 Secondary groups. Primary groups play a vital role in the person's life. However, there are secondary groups provide any terminology for the groups other than primary groups, and many writers came to speak of secondary groups. The tendency has been to consider secondary groups as those which help or which depend for communication on indirect media such as newspaper, Paris 1937. Repeat it. Primary groups play a vital role in a person's life. However, there are secondary groups which fulfill their maximum needs in life. Cooley did not provide any terminology for the groups other than the primary groups, and many writers came to speak of secondary groups. The tendency has been to consider secondary groups as those which depend for the communication on indirect media such as newspapers, Paris 1937. In secondary groups, the relations are formal, impersonal, segmental, and utilitarian. These groups are less intimate as the level of interaction is restricted at a formal level. They do not give close identity to its members as primary groups do. In secondary groups, we very often interact with people of diverse background because we need their services and we have certain obligations to fulfill. In case of utilitarian or contractual obligations, there is no need to develop personal relations. These relations remain based on reciprocal needs. Hence, members of these groups regard each other as means, not an end in themselves. McLaver and Page 1952 has pointed out that primary groups relations are characteristics of simple or primitive societies as the population and territory of the society increases, interest would have become diversified, and so the needs it gave rise to the need of indirect, impersonal, and utilitarian relations. He called these newly emerged impersonal relations as great associations. They are result of expansion of population and perhaps primarily of growing cultural complexity. He considers secondary group a character of industrialized and urbanized complex societies. In these societies, due to complexity in the nature of work, more complicated relations developed, which provides a very limited scope for intimate relations. Ogburn and Nemkov, 1966, say that the groups which provide experience lacking in intimacy can be called as secondary group. Here by experience, he means the interaction with the varied kind of people in day-to-day life. At one hand, secondary groups fulfill majority of the needs of the individual or of an individual. On the other hand, they also separate individuals' activities from the rest of the activities, because in secondary group context, every individual is supposed to play his own part. It also segments individuals' personality in contrast to primary groups, where his whole personality reflects. Reflection. Typical examples of secondary group. First, a group of co-workers. A group of people working together in the same organization form a secondary group, as they have impersonal relations but spend most of the time together in the organization. Second, clubs. Clubs are formed in order to fulfill some of the requirements of social life, as fun clubs or sport clubs for entertainment, charity clubs for contributions or donations, hobby clubs for leisure pursuits, and many more. These clubs are utilitarian in nature and form a secondary group, as members of the group are less intimate. Third is university or college. University or college also form secondary group, as they are segmental in nature. People are dependent on colleges for educational requirement, but it reflects just a part of their personality, and people form formal contacts. In order to understand secondary groups in a more appropriate manner, let us look into their characteristics. 2.3.1 Characteristics of secondary groups. Dominance of secondary relations. Secondary groups relations can be seen in reference to primary relations. Secondary group relations are impersonal, indirect, non-inclusive and utilitarian. Members are connected to each other through contractual obligation or interest. Due to self-interest, individuality develops among the members. Second, voluntary membership. Individuals are free to join or leave the group at any point of time. That is, membership of these groups are predominantly voluntary. But in case of secondary groups like state, membership becomes compulsory. Large in size. Third is large in size. Unlike a primary group, physical proximity is not the condition for secondary group, and so size of secondary group becomes large. They might spread all over the world. For example, members of PETA, P-E-T-A, People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals, are scattered all over the world. Fourth is goal-oriented, that is, secondary groups are formed in order to fulfill the needs of the individuals. They serve the special functions in the society. Every secondary group emerges in response to specific purpose and joins the people having same type of need. Fifth is indirect communication. Mode of communication among the members of the secondary group is indirect. In many of the cases, group members seldom or rarely or never come into direct contact to each other. They rely on different forms of mass media communication, which include radio, telephone, television, newspaper, movies, magazine, post and telegraph, etc. Last one is role decides a person's position. In secondary groups, position of a person depends upon his role, socially achieved status, and its corresponding role remains the key factor behind the position of a person in the secondary group. His position is not decided by his ascribed status, neither he is treated on the basis of his birth. However, an individual fulfills its majority of needs through the secondary groups. Yet these groups are not exclusive and cannot replace its importance of the primary groups. In modern society, many of the former relation or functions of the primary groups have been assumed by large, impersonal, goal-oriented groups. Each of these secondary groups create a new network of primary groups that provide intimacy and personal response in many impersonal situations also. So we should not see both of them mutually exclusive. The inflexible classification of groups into primary and secondary is not preferable, as there is much overlapping of these two or of the two. Kingsley Davis, 1957, writes that Cooley's emphasis on we, feeling, cannot be taken as the distinctive element in the primary group, as such feeling to some extent is necessary for any enduring community. In between primary group, like the family and the formal and rigid groups, like army, there are hundreds of groups, some of which are more primary than others. Even in modern organizations, efforts are made to create a friendly atmosphere among the employees. Hence, we can say that in modern societies, both primary and secondary groups are important, and it is not easy to substitute one for the other. Action. First is identify the various people with which you interact often and try to categorize them into primary and secondary group members in your reference. Second, classify the following groups into primary and secondary groups: nuclear family, sports team, FCCI, alcoholic anonymous, unmarried partners, fraternal groups, army battalion, neighborhood watch, cancer support club, co-workers, church congregation, mafia brothers, democratic party, polo club, college clique, boy scout troop, rotary club, senior citizen club. Community 2.4. Community. We have understood the concept of group in the above discussion. The elementary point of a social group is the presence of social relations. Now just think of a group in which an individual spends most of the time of his life, and what if this group is restricted to a particular locality or place or a geographical area? It becomes a community in which people spend most of their time and keep a feeling of belonging with it. A community is called as a collection of people with residential ties to particular locality. It is the territorial boundary which differentiates a community with other groups, because the concept of group is not restricted to a particular locality. It may be considered as a permanent local aggregation of people having diversified as well as common interests. Word community is comprised of two Latin words, namely com and munis. In English, com means to gather and munis means to serve. Thus, community means to serve together. It implies that the purpose of a community is to serve. According to McLaver and Page 1952, community is a group of people who live together, who belong together, so that they share not ties or that particular interest, but as a whole set of interest, wide enough and complete enough to include their lives. Kingsley Davis, 1957, has defined community as the smallest territorial group that can embrace all the aspects of the social life. These definitions give emphasis on the structural and functional aspect of the community, while we should keep in mind that community is not an exclusive entity. It should not be seen as a separate part of society. They are within the society and form their integral part. An individual cannot live his whole life within an organization or an association, while he can live his life in a village or in a city. So we can say that community provides the individual a conducive environment to live wholly within it, and also summarize his social relationships within it. In the simple societies, communities are considered as self-sufficient, but in modern time, character of community has become very complex. Moreover, community is a relative term. People live within a greater community, such as a village within a district a district within a region within a state within a country, and a country within a whole world. Sometimes it becomes difficult to differentiate a community from other social form like society or groups, society and groups. But there are some basic characteristics, features of the communities. Characteristics of a community, first is definitive geographical area. Community is a special entity. A community is always considered in relation to a physical geographical area or a territory. It is compulsory condition for a community, but it should not be confused with those groups who live together without any separate physical boundary. As four friends living in a room do not form a community. A community is a broader term. We feeling or community feeling. It is home instinct. It is home instinct which lays the foundation of people's attachment to their house, community or nation. It is the we feeling through which people recognizes their community and themselves. Community sentiments develop during a period of time within community. Third is common culture and common life. Life of a people is a community, more or less same. Life of the people in a community is more or less same due to their common ecological conditions. They develop some same type of culture, habit and behavioral patterns. Cultural uniformity and uniformity in their mode of life can be observed. Fourth is close relationships. As a person mostly lives in a community, proximate relations develop. Collective participations become a common affair which brings people together and gives a chance to primary relations to develop. Thus, the psychological feeling of a community become more important. Fifth is competitiveness of life. Completeness of life, not a competitiveness, completeness of a life. Community covers all the aspects of life. Community helps in the socialization and also helps in developing the community sentiments in a person as well. Sixth is permanent nature. Communities are never formed with any particular aim or objective. It grows itself spontaneously and so it is durable. Last is not a legal body. A community is not a legal body. That is, it cannot sue nor it can be sued. In the eyes of law, community has no rights and duties. Apart from these basic elements, community shares feeling of oneness and has a particular name. Though a community does not form with a particular aim, its ends remain wider and natural. McLever and Page 1952 has considered village and tribal societies as the best examples of community. Apart from it, they have also kept asylum and prison into the category of community. 2.5 Association. In our day-to-day life, we come across the number of associations like Traders Association and Urban Development Association, etc. But we hardly pay any attention to what an association is. In anthropology, association represents a group created for fulfillment of common needs. Human beings can fulfill their needs through three ways. One, independently, second, through conflict with one another, and the third, in cooperative basis, that is, in company. This cooperative pursuit may be determined by customs of the community. So, when a group organizes itself especially for the purpose of pursuing certain interests, an association is born. As McLever and Page 1952 says that an association is an organization deliberately formed for the collective pursuit of same interest or set of interest which its members share. This definition clearly indicates the nature of association, its structure and functions. Hence, it can be said that an association is a group of people organized for a particular purpose. It implies that there are certain conditions to constitute an association. Firstly, there must be a group of people. Secondly, the group of people should be organized. That is, there must be a certain rules for conduct. Thirdly, there must be common purpose of the specific nature to follow. Firstly, there must be a group of people. Secondly, the group of people should be organized. That is, there must be a certain of rules for conduct. Thirdly, there must be common purpose of the specific nature to follow. Since men have several interests and several purpose to pursue, they establish many associations to fulfill them. For example, political associations to serve the political motives, student associations to give out student welfare, professional associations like ICMR, Indian Council of Medical Research, FICCI, FICCI, Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry, Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry to serve the interest of concerned people, and international associations like Rotary Club, YMCA, Young Men's Christians Association, etc. As society moves towards complexity, needs of the human beings also become diversified, and this finally leads to more and more number of associations. In contemporary times, associations perform more than their conventional functions. Now people use associations to discharge their social obligations. Society is considered as a combination of associations, and healthy associations represents a healthy society. Characteristics of association. Associations require at least two individuals. It is considered as a concrete form of group. Association has its own aims and objectives. No association can be formed without any aim. Aim can be broad or particular. Association is always a result of deliberative actions. Like communities, they do not grow spontaneously. They are deliberately created by man in order to fulfill certain aims. In an association, membership remains voluntary. Members can join the association or establish an association as per their needs. There are certain rules to get membership of an association. Every association establishes on the grounds of certain rules and regulations. It also contains code of conduct for the members. On any contradictory action or disobeying the regulations, a member may be expelled from the membership. Associations are subjected to be terminated. The life of an association is up to the achievement of the aim for which it has been created. The existence of the association after the achievement of the objectives becomes meaningless and immaterial. In simple societies where there is less division of labor, there are a few associations and they are more inclusive. Thus, they lack specific, limited functional character. They take such forms as age groups, kin groups, and sex groups, etc. While in modern societies, associations tend to be specialized so that each stands for a particular type of interest. So we see that associations are formed to achieve certain general goals, and in order to attain these goals, certain rules and regulations are developed. Formation of an association can be understood from the following examples. In society, everybody needs a house to live. In society, everybody needs a house to live. It is everybody's aim, but can we achieve it by our own exclusive efforts and resources? The answer is no. And for that purpose, Housing and Urban Development Corporation, HUDCO, HUDCO, was established. Associations are formed in this manner only as needs increased, people kept on making associations to meet those needs. Hence, we can say that associations are those functional units of the society through which a man fulfills his basic social needs. They are deliberately formed in order to attain certain purposes, reflection and action. A family, a school and hospital associations. This is a question. If we observe them carefully, we find that all of these three have following characteristics. First, more than one member. Second, a definite structure. Third, have specific aims and objectives. Fourth, voluntary membership. After a certain period of time, one can decide that whether he or she wants to stay in the family or not. On the basis of the above features, family, school and hospital can be considered as association. Activity. First, differentiate between community, association and society. Second, make a list of all these associations to which you belong. 2.6. Organizations, formal and informal. Now we know about social groups, communities and associations. We learnt in association that they are organized groups with a specific purpose, while organizations are those associations of individuals through which certain value-oriented interests are satisfied. They are systematically arranged units of individuals in which each person have a formal status of role. Formal status and role. Anderson and Parker, 1966. Repeated. Now we know about the social groups, communities and associations. We learnt in the association that they are the organized groups with a specific purpose, while organizations are those associations of individuals through which certain values-oriented interests are satisfied. They are systematically arranged units of individuals in which each person has a formal status and role. Anderson and Parker, 1966. Organizations are principally formed in order to attain certain goals. They emerge when explicit producers are established to coordinate the activities of a group in the interest of achieving specific objectives. The collective effort of the members of the group may become formally organized either because all of them have some common interest or because a subgroup has furnished inducements to the rest to the work on behalf of its interest. Trade unions, government bureaus and army are few examples of the organization. Organizations are principally formed in order to attain certain goals. They emerge when explicit producers are established to coordinate the activities of a group in the interest of achieving specific objectives. The collective effort of the members of the group may become formally organized either because all of them have some common interest or because a subgroup has furnished inducements to the rest of the work, to the work on behalf of its interests. Trade unions, government bureaus, and army are few examples of the organization. In modern society, needs of human being are diversified and so a number of organizations exist. Organizations provide a medium for expressions. The interests like education, architecture, music, sports, cultural activities, etc. Parsons, 1960, says that organizations are social units that are deliberately constructed and reconstructed to pursue specific goals. Organizations are social units that are deliberately constructed and reconstructed to pursue specific goals. The government, trade unions, sports authorities, and clubs are social structures formed to achieve certain objectives with special purposes. These all are counted as organization. Generally, organizations can be divided into formal and informal organizations. An organization is developed when there is a collectivity of people associated with one another. An organization is developed when there is collectivity of people associated with one another, but a mere collection of individuals does not form a formal organization. The defining criteria of a formal organization is the existence of producers for mobilizing and coordinating the efforts of various usually specialized subgroups in the pursuit of joint objectives. Former organizations are further divided into four types on the basis who benefits from the organization. One type of mutual benefits organizations where the members are beneficiaries, for example, a labor union. Another type of representation. Another type is represented by business concerns where the main beneficiaries are owners. Third type is client-concentric. Third type is client-centered, as in case of service organizations. The fourth type is commonwealth organizations, which are meant for the benefit of the public. Formal organization has fixed set of rules of intra-organization producers and structures. These rules are set off in writing. These rules are set out in writings, leaving a little scope for interpretation. In some societies or in some organizations, such rules may be strictly followed. In others, they remain at the level of formalization only. The informal organizations are informally organized by the participants themselves, and they complement those formally organized for them by the management. It is the interlocking social structure that governs how people work together in practice. It is the aggregate of behaviors, interaction, norms, personal and professional connections through which the work gets done, and relationships are built among people who share a common organizational affiliation. It consists of a dynamic set of personal relationships, social networks, communities of common interest, and emotional sources of motivation. Informal organizations originate or evolve spontaneously in response to change in the work environment. Characteristics of formal organization: enduring unless deliberately altered. Static, very specified written rules. Equates person with roles. Hierarchical. People are bounded together with formal rules and procedures, while informal organizations have following characteristics. Evolve or emerge spontaneously. Informal organizations' characteristics are evolve or emerge spontaneously, dynamic and responsive. Rules are not specified. If written, treat people as individuals. No hierarchical relations. Membership of an organization, along with its privileges, entails duties and responsibilities. It is just like availing a new status in order to make the individual aware of his new responsibilities and status. Many organizations go through the initiation ceremony along with oath-taking processes. Some organizations maintain secrecy, which builds a kind of social distance between members and outsiders. For example, Mau Mau, a secret organization of West Africa, Varghese, 1992. In a large organization, many smaller organizations exist. These smaller organizations, which are themselves formal organizations, work as subunits of larger network. This whole network of organization and its subunit is known as complex organization. Its zioni, 1961, opinions or its opinion or her opinion. Complex organizations constitute one of the most important elements which make up social web of modern societies. Most citizens of modern societies are born in a hospital, educated in a school, work in and one organization or another, work in one organization or another, and to the degree that they participate in religious and political activities. These two frequently take place in complex organization. In short, member of modern societies obtain a larger part of their material, social and cultural satisfaction from large scale organizations. Activity. First, name five formal and informal organizations found in your society. Second, found out the characteristics of bureaucratic organization of your society. Modern organization differed in three ways with social groups. First, division of labor. Second, power centers. Third, substitution of personnel. Contemporary organizations are specialized and are likely to be formed when there is a complementary or common interest which may bring the members together for activities of mutual interest. Summary. In this unit, you have learned about social groups including primary, secondary groups, communities, associations and formal and informal organizations. Social groups are based on social interaction and the degree of interaction decides the nature of the groups, while community is a special phenomenon having we feeling. On the other hand, association and organization are formed in order to fulfill certain purpose with specific objectives. These concepts would help you in understanding the society and its structure in the better way. Sample questions are: primary groups play a pivotal role in a person's life experience. Second, primary groups can be formed within the secondary group, commented. Third, how a community different from an association. Fourth is organizations form a network of roles and duties, elucidate.